Hi, I'm Gurumurthy Kasinathan. I'm the director of IT for Change. You can call me Guru. I'll be your course mentor for the second week of this MOOC on OER. And during the second week, we will discuss the topic of copyright. We'll also discuss adoption of OER. I look forward to all of you engaging with the readings that have been provided as a part of this MOOC for week 2. I also hope we will have occasion for online chat, and I will be available during the week at specified times for chatting with all of you. There are also some interesting videos that have been put together for this MOOC, and I hope you will have time to go through them. And I hope you will enjoy the second week as well, like you have been enjoying this first week where we had an introduction to OERs by Professor Ramesh Sharma. I've made a small mind map to explore the topic of copyright, and I'll just talk about it for a few minutes. I think when we talk about copyright, it's useful to go back to the history where the idea of copyright originated, and looking at what history tells us, I think the idea of copyright actually began from the idea of property, that the person who has created an asset or the person who has purchased an asset should own it. That particular item should become the property of the person who has created or owned it. And the person who is the owner of the property should be allowed to have perpetual use and control. Perpetual would mean indefinitely, without a finite period of time. The owner should be allowed to use the property, and the owner should be able to control the use of the property as well. By control the use of property, we mean the user can decide who else can use the property and set terms for its use. The owner can also sell the property, of course, in which case the buyer then becomes the owner of the property and gets all the rights that the seller had. We are familiar with the economic ideologies or the economic theories of socialism and capitalism, and one of the key distinctions between these two economic ideologies is simply in the treatment of property. Whereas socialism tried to say that all means of production and basically all social resources of society should be owned by all, and therefore no one individual would be able to determine or control its use by others. Thereby there would be no such thing as private property. In capitalism, private property is an extremely important, even a fundamental principle of that ideology. In fact, many people who are economists write about how the law of property is one of the most fundamental principles of capitalism. And capitalism, of course, tries to enrich and enhance the arena of private property. And we are familiar with the whole debate, for example, in India over the idea of water. And there are projects to privatize water to make it a private good, because there are arguments that by making water a private property, its distribution will be made much more efficient and society will benefit from that. But we all know that no economy in the world is a pure socialist economy. Even communist China cannot claim to be a pure socialist economy. And there is no pure capitalist economy as well. We are all mixed economies now, where property is certainly protected, but there are limitations imposed by society and law on the extent to which property rights are allowed. So property is a very interesting idea, and we seem to sometimes, some of us may think that property is a divine right, you know, that it is bestowed on us in a very intrinsic and inherent manner, but we should understand that property is another right that society and law allows us, just like many other rights that we have, and therefore society can decide in ways to relax it or enforce it in the ways that they want. From property, let us go on. Property is, of course, relating to tangible goods, a house, a factory, clothes, furniture. So property primarily relates to tangible goods. In the last few centuries, ideas have proliferated, and of course we have heard of the Age of Enlightenment and, you know, the Renaissance period, where knowledge itself acquired a place of importance in society. This also was with the spread of science and learning, and many scientists and many philosophers came up with many, many ideas which were very useful contributions to society. Now, whether an idea of a person would itself become a property which that particular person could enjoy as a right is an idea, is an important discussion in itself. And here I would like to talk about a very important quote that George Bernard Shaw, who is a very famous British writer and intellectual, said. I'll read the quote. He said, "If you have an apple and I have an apple and we exchange these apples, then you and I will still have each have only one apple. But if you have an idea and I have an idea and we exchange these ideas, then each of us will have two ideas." So a very important principle by which in which in an idea is different from property is that a property tends to be something which is exclusive. It can only belong to one person at a time. Of course, when it's a one person, joint ownership is still possible. But there is a clear distinction and demarcation between people who own it and people who don't own it. Whereas with ideas, that demarcation is not extremely clear or strong. I can have an idea, I can share the ideas with others. And when I share the ideas with the others, they have the idea too. And when they have the idea, I don't lose it, which is not the case with physical property. So therefore, intellect, looking at intellect as property itself is a very problematic thing, and many people have strongly criticized the term intellectual property that we commonly use. And they say that what we call intellectual property is really three different kinds of ideas. One is, of course, copyright, which is pertaining to literary work, writings. Those are subject to idea of copyright. Intellectual property, the so-called intellectual property, also comprises of patents, which is, you know, granted on ideas that result in tangible products, which could be, you know, pharmaceutical patents or things like that, and trademarks, which are simply that businesses' logos and business similar graphics and text which businesses have been using for a long time and which they would not like others to use and which society allows them some kind of control on use, which are trademarks. So people say that ideas are of which can be seen as property like can be broken up into copyright, patent and trademarks. Now, one of the things to remember in this area is that copyright, unlike property, does not have an indefinite right. Whereas in the case of property, if you own a property, pretty much you own it over your lifetime, and you can will it to somebody else who can own it over their lifetime, and then it can perennially, it is owned by a private party. In the case of ideas, because in the case of ideas, that kind of a perpetuity is not there. So for a long time, it was, the law said that the idea belongs to a person who has created it. So long as that person is alive, the idea is almost like his property, and the author can benefit from having created that idea. But over a period of time, what we have seen is that the copyright law has been amended from time and again, so that the rights of the copyright owners have been increasing over time. And right now, in most countries, including India, copyright vests with the author, so long as the author is alive. And for 50 years after the death of the author, till that time, the author can actually will that particular right to somebody else. But after 50 years after the death of the author, the writing necessarily comes into the public domain. Public domain is a space where there is no copyright of any particular entity. It belongs to everybody. And therefore, writings will move from copyright to the public domain over a period of time. For example, Gandhi's writings. Gandhi has been dead for more than 50 years, so all of Gandhi's writings are in the public domain. And you can borrow it, you can reuse it in the way that you want to use. The logic for not allowing perpetual use is also from the fact that it is very difficult for a creator of an idea to say that the idea completely came from within him or her. in most cases, what we find is the ideas come from the prior learning of that person, and the prior learning itself was dependent on ideas that other people have created. That being the case, it's very unfair for a person to say it's my idea, because where did this idea come from? It only came from my own education, my own learning, my own exposure, in which other people have had a role to contribute. In fact, we remember Isaac Newton's very famous quotation. Isaac Newton was praised for his invention or the discovery of the laws of nature in terms of laws of motion and many other things that he invented, including calculus. And Isaac Newton just had this to say, that I stood on the shoulders of giants and therefore I was able to see more. And he characterized himself as an ordinary person who had benefited from the works of giants prior. And that, I think, is humility, and also reflects the fact that ideas cannot belong to a person exclusively. They are built on work done earlier. Now, in the digital age, when we find that sharing of ideas is so easy, you know, copy-paste is one of the most popular activities when we use software tools, which may be not only a text editor but also a video editor or anything like that. Copy-paste is so easy. Control-C, Control-V are very much a part of the computer lexicon. When that is so easy, then how do we allow copyright? How do we enforce copyright in the digital age? This is a discussion I think that we can have. I'll now move on to the kinds of rights that are allowed, or the kinds of rights that can be visualized as far as intellectual outputs are concerned. And you will talk more about them not only in week 2, but you'll also discuss them in week 3 and week 4. So these are the following rights, and they're pretty much simple and easy to understand. First is, I would say, the right of attribution. Attribution simply says, if I created an idea, society should recognize that I am the author of that idea. And whenever that idea is spoken about, it should be also mentioned that the creator of this idea was so and so person. And this we use very normally. For example, even though Isaac Newton did not copyright the laws of motion and said people cannot use these laws elsewhere, even then we would always say the laws of Newton as discovered by Isaac Newton, or as written about by Isaac Newton. So attribution, that is giving credit for an idea, is a very important right. And we find that this is the right society inherently respects. So we say that Story of My Experiments with Truth is a autobiography written by Gandhi. Now, although the copyright on that particular book has expired, because it's more than 50 years since Gandhi died, but I cannot imagine that there will be a time when anybody would deny or not mention that the Story of My Experiments of Truth has been written by Gandhi. The right to reuse, of course, that if I have an idea, I can reuse that idea again and again. I've written a poem, I can read that poem again and again. I can retain it, I can keep it with me for posterity. I can make changes to that poem. I can add an additional stanza, I can change a phrase, I can make the rhyming sequence different. I can give it to others. I can also sell it. I can sell the rights to it. I can license the rights to it. So these are the various kinds of intellectual rights on intellectual outputs that one can have. Now, conventionally, what happens is all these authors' rights, if nothing is mentioned, then we have the right called Big C. There's a very interesting video during this week which talks about the Big C, and the Big C, which you see in most books, many books, simply means all rights reserved. Now, all rights means that the author has all the rights that I have mentioned above, what I discussed here, all these rights. And not only does the author have all these rights, the author can prevent others from exercising those rights with respect to this particular output. The author can prevent others from using that, others from retaining it, making copies of it, distributing it to others, or making changes to it. And this all rights reserved is a default copyright. So I don't have to, if I write a poem and I write my name below it, I don't have to actually declare all rights reserved. If I don't say anything, the default is all rights reserved. And this is a very important thing to remember, because sometimes we wrongly assume that just because I found something on the internet, I found an article on the internet, it means I can share it. If nothing is mentioned, by default it is all rights reserved, and therefore I do not have a right to download it, keep it with myself, or make copies of it. There are exceptions even to all rights reserved. For example, the right of fair use is fairly well known. Fair use means if I'm writing a review of a poem, I may want to quote a part of the poem or some of the lines of the poem in the review itself, because my review will not make sense without those quotations. So in I can use other people's work to some extent as is relevant for making my work relevant. And what exactly is fair use is not defined very rigidly. Factors like how much of the original work I'm borrowing and whether I'm making interpretations, etc., are all factors considered to decide whether I'm making a fair use of it or not. What we are going to learn in this particular course, of course, is the idea of some rights reserved. So we are saying that every time it doesn't have to be all rights reserved. I can have some rights, I can relax some rights. And all these rights, whichever I keep or I retain, I can specify that in my license. So instead of just putting a big C, if I put a double C, then I'm using a license called Creative Commons, and in that I can actually specify which rights I want to keep and which I want to give away. So, important thing is the right to retain I will not give away. I will always have the right to retain the particular output even though I give it to others through a Creative Commons license. I retain the right to keep it with me. I have the right to retain it. I have the right to reuse it. I also, of course, have the right to distribute it. So these are three basic rights which I will have. Whether I want to be cited as the author or not is determined by using a whether I have the right to attribution, which in Creative Commons goes by. If I put a by clause, then it means the person using that particular idea has to attribute it to me. If I put a ND, that is a non-derivative clause, it means if the other person is using it, the other person can't make changes to it. They have to use it exactly in the way I have created it. SA or share alike means if they make changes, then they also have to share it with the changes in the same license that I have used while sharing that particular output. And NC means I do not give them the right to make money out of it. I don't give them the right to sell or license it. They can use it for non-commercial license, for non-commercial use. I would like a couple of discussions on these two on these ideas. Supposing you are an author and you want to relax some rights and keep some rights, what rights would you relax and what rights you would retain? Why? And in a related manner, amongst all these rights, do you think there's a hierarchy? Do you think attribution is more important? Or share alike is more important? Or non-commercial is more important? What kind of rights do you think are important from an author's point of view? Or maybe to put it even in a different way, under what circumstances do you think authors would like to relax different kinds of rights? So this is a short presentation I had. This particular mind map also I will make it available on the course where itself. I look forward to participation from all of you. I am Guru here saying thank you and thanks for your patient listening. Look forward to discussions with you. Bye.